With regard to tonight, let me introduce the our panel. Many of you know them, and so they almost need no introduction, but they'll be talking about mind dynamics and understanding the dynamics of the mind. They made some new advances in mind consciousness development and remote viewing communications. And a lot of the work will say that we're really not isolated. I think a lot of you know that, and we're all connected. Elizabeth Rauscher received her PhD in physics from UC Berkeley. She was a nuclear scientist, astrophysicist, and researcher at the Lawrence Berkeley National Labs, and was featured in the book of How the Hippies Saved Physics. She's been the author of many papers, 275 papers and 6 books and patents, including with her late husband, the non-conducting magnetometer. And she worked on remote viewing studies in the 70s in broad field of interest, nuclear and atomic physics, astrophysics, cosmological models, plasma physics, biomedical engineering, and geophysics monitoring. And with regard to JJ and Desiree, their PhDs are from the University of California and University of Minnesota. And they're founders of the Academy for Future Science. It's a non-governmental organization with the United Nations. They are social scientists and have written and translated many, many books. JJ Hurtak is author of The Book of Knowledge, The Keys of Enoch. It's a book on future cosmology. And they've worked in many, many fields, from archaeology to remote sensing to new energy technologies, space law, and consciousness development. So with that, let me just turn it over to our panel and to Elizabeth. And thank you very much for being here.
Be nearsighted and then got glasses for foresight. I can't see either. That's why I have to remote view. Oh. Practicality. Okay. Being from Berkeley doesn't always mean you're a hippie. In fact, I was a conservative skeptic and did not believe in psychic phenomena, although I had some experiences that piqued my interest as a kid. So what I found is to approach everything as an open-minded skeptic. What it means is if something is true and you determine that it's true or you find a weight of evidence that it's true, then you go with the truth and change your philosophy to update it to what you need to be and do. So I was very fortunate. I called up Russell Targ and Hal Porthoff at SRI. I said, what's going on? I'd like to find out. They said, oh, come on down. Then the next morning, the phone rang while I was meditating. I thought, oh, no, that's Hal canceling the meeting. And it was. So I said, oh, no. I said, you guys have to go to lunch, don't you? And so I went down, went to lunch with Russell, Hal, Ingo Swan. And then we formed a fantastic relationship, and man, I spent 3 days changing my philosophy. I'm getting more efficient now.
You passed an initial psychic interview over the phone, didn't you?
Yeah, that's right. You said, what's on my desk? And I said, I see a ball and socket joint, and it was a crystal ball in a wooden cup, and that's what it was, a ball and socket joint. But that, if I didn't pass that, I would have never got together with you, right? Oh, I did that with Dale Groff. He said, what was on his desk? And I said, it's an S-shaped thing fastened at the bottom, and it was a snake. It was S-shaped. So, you know, now you're getting involved with the inner club relationships. Anyway, I tell you what. It's an interconnected world, and what I'm going to explore with you this evening is not only the interconnection of mind, but how that's prominent in the whole nature of fundamental physics. Now, why physics has a role is because it's the simplest of all sciences, so we know more about it, and that's why it seems like the most complicated of all sciences. Because you might be able to say that the reason a thing falls to Earth is it has a propensity to do so, or gravity sucks. But in fact, we do have laws to describe that. Where if we say, why does a cell incorporate a mitochondria to do ATP metabolism, why, not how, we can't answer that. So why a thing falls to Earth is because there's gravity, but biology and sociology, all that's so too complicated for me. I just stick to the simple stuff. Theoretical, nuclear, and astrophysics, very simple. So what I did is a whole bunch of experiments with three different groups. One was SRI, one was what I call the Berkeley Research Group, which I put together, one of some of the SRI people and other people, and then the Fundamental Physics Group, which is just described in How the Hippies Say Physics. Now what that book shows is one of the most fundamental aspects of physics, and that's quantum entanglement, which we'll get into a little bit more later. For those who are not initiated into remote viewing, I'll say something about it, but first I'll tell you about my funding organization. It's the other CIA, the Consciousness Investigation Association. It turns out they have zero funding. that's me at the Bevershorn Accelerator in Berkeley. And tragically, if I had a hanky, I'd cry. They destroyed this most fantastic machine. And I'm one of those kids that, you know, man, if I saw a fantastic machine, I just was fascinated. And but it did its job, and it was a really interesting era. I was both in the nuclear science and the theoretical physics divisions. And one of the questions I always had is, what is the topic for today? What is reality? So I looked it up in Webster's dictionary. It said truth, real, correct, and it turned out to be a tautology, and it turned out that Webster doesn't know the answer. I'm not sure anybody else does either, but that's another point. Anyway, so what our society tends to have done is to divide things up into mind, body, and spirit. And the mind-body duality has been a big topic, but it's actually part of what came out of the Renaissance later as the mind-body duality. But then if it's completely separate, maybe I raise my arm and I'm PKing it by my mind in the most extreme model. Anyway, experiment without inspiration or imagination, without recourse to experiment, can accomplish little. But for an effective progress, a happy blend of these powers is necessary. Now, as a theoretical physicist, I've done a lot of experiments. And it's both. It's a theory really is to explain what a set of observations mean and to project into the future predictions about the next experiment you're going to do. And I saw these people running the rats in the rat mazes, the nice white rats. And what they would do is they picked a rat up, pet it, and put it in a cage, put it in a maze, and then run it around and shock it. And I thought, boy, that rat's going to be driven nuts. I mean, it's cognitive dissonance of the first order. The guy is shocking me, is petting me. What? And life sort of seems like that sometimes, right? So the first group is the Fundamental Physics Group. I had about 40 physicists. I started and chaired it, and then worked with the wonderful Stanford Research Radio Physics Group, and then Jack Houck with McDonnell Douglas, now Douglas Aircraft, and I've conducted over 80 experiments, a local long distance. This was prior to doing all the experiments, and with odds of millions of one against chance. And in fact, almost every experiment succeeded. I only had a few that came out at chance. And it's amazing, because we really are fundamentally connected. And it's actually more to me sociology that makes the separation, not the fundamental nature of consciousness. And this is the group You might recognize me in my younger days, and then Ed May, Hal Poroff, and Russell Targ at SRI. Now, what you do in a remote viewing experiment is the more careful you do the experiment, the better the results. And so you have a subject participant in a laboratory room. What that is the secretary or engineer down the hall that's free after lunch to play remote viewing. In some cases, it was superstars like Ingo Swann and Pat Price. Then you have a monitor with the subject to respond and ask questions there, like the left hemisphere asking the right hemisphere. You have to ask open-ended questions, because if you say, where's the outbound team, you've just screwed the experiment. You have to actually have gentle interaction. Also, you keep out interlopers that have cell phones. This doesn't seem to be working. Oh, it's just faintly. Oh no, is the battery dead? Does someone have a pointer? Yeah, I think. Oh, now it's going.
It was working. It's made in China.
My thumb is busted. See that hole in it? Man, that's a tough button. And then you have pen and paper, no cell phones or laptops. Outbound person randomly chooses prior chosen targets by what I call the coordinator. Put them in a safe, take six out to six to eight. Then the outbound team gets six or eight targets, randomizes them in sealed blank envelopes, randomly chooses one with a random number generator and goes to a target 30 minutes away, approximately for 15 minutes. Now, everybody has to play their role. One thing is, an outbound person actually has to go somewhere and be conscious and be there for 15 minutes. Because if they're dreaming about their ex-husband in Hawaii and they're at a church, you're going to have hula girls. In fact, another experimenter got that. So it's a lesson in being conscious. Remote perception is recorded for 15 minutes by the subject and by the outbound team. They wait, they come back, the subject is taken from the target for feedback. That's very important. Even when the feedback was years later, it still was really helpful to have feedback. Not all experiments that succeeded needed feedback, but it's part of it. And we use three different judging processes. I'm only going to talk about one here. One is human judges. I had as many as five judges for one set of six targets and transcripts by the subject. And actually, they were pretty much intercorrelated or the same. It's just that, and I had skeptics and people that believed in psi, and they judged pretty much the same. Or computer judging, and I'll talk about two different computer program judging systems. This is the first experiment I was formally involved with at SRI, and Jeff Mishlov, who wrote The Roots of Consciousness, was the subject. And I think it was one of the first times he was the subject. The target that was chosen randomly by me and an outbound person with me was the overpass of El Camino, the Oregon overpass. And that was the target, and these two pictures were taken at the before the experiment. The subject said it looked like a church archway and we were walking through. I think it was Jim Hickman and me. And it looks like hangers on a line without the clothes. And I looked up against the sky, saw the cyclone fence, and it looked like crosswires, and that's what he described, was crosswires against the blue sky. About halfway through the experiment, as I'm feeling the cyclone fence and transmitting my psychic imagery, a cop in shorts comes up, kind of an old guy, and he says, what are you doing? And I said, I'm doing a remote viewing experiment with a subject back at SRI, and I have my clipboard, so I look like maybe I'm trying to make plans for something nefarious. And got my tape recorder and my camera and everything, and I explained the protocol, and he looked at me really funny, and then he went back to his squad car. He phoned in, this is a 50-50. Means crazy but harmless, I found out later.
Can I add something here?
Yeah.
People often say, well, what part does the interviewer, do you really need the interviewer? If you got the psychic out there and then he comes back. I was the interviewer here with Jeff Mishlow, and Jeffrey had never done a remote viewing experiment before.
So I sat with him and I said, Elizabeth has gone to a target now. I have no idea what it was. Can you tell me what you're experiencing? Which is what I always say. And he said, yes, it looks to me like Macy's department store. Now, from my experience, I knew that that did not sound like remote viewing, because the remote viewer doesn't know what it is. What I want him to do is tell me what he's experiencing.
Wow.
So I said, okay, Jeffrey, don't tell me about Macy's. Just tell me what you're experiencing. What are the surprising things that come into your awareness? And he said, well, I see these things that look like hangers. If you look up in the sky, there's all these hangers, one after another, on a pole. And then he drew that picture on the right. But the point is, without an interviewer, see, I'm of course blind, and I never know the answer. So I'm always, my job is, for 10 years, I sat in the dark helping people develop their psychic ability. That was my job. So in this instance, without an interviewer who's really attuned to what ESP sounds like, you'd have never gotten this result.
Absolutely.
I didn't tell him what to do, and I didn't know what the answer was, but I knew what ESP sounds like.
Tone of voice, whether they speak slowly, if they speak fast, it's not usually psychic.
Often they'll look up. If they open their eyes, they'll look up in one direction, up to the right or the left. And Russell is the master of this science because he's the one that was a key person in making it work, really. I credit him with really the foundation of this project. And Ingo Swan, Pat Price, and some of the other people. But that is the answer. If you want to do this experiment, that is the key. This one was a very nice one. Hal Portoff and me were outbound, and the subject was Gary Langford, and he was across the country on travel. And what came up was the target was the underpass at El Camino Real and University Avenue. It's a tunnel, and cars drive through it, and you could walk along it and then peek in over it. Also, you know, Macy's department store was in that target pool, Russell. That's interesting. Anyway, so he did left-hand drawing and right-hand drawing, but he said, we're in a tube, and I was hanging over the edge, listening to the traffic, and yell Gary and tell him where we are. And he drew these pictures, and he said, I hesitate to say it, but I think you're under the underpass at El Camino and Real and named the place correctly. But he was really good, and he had no idea where we were going to go in the Bay Area. I mean, after a while, there's no choice but to say, man, the world is really neat. This one was Russell outbound, and he's a good sender, too. And so I'm sitting there with Gary Langford, and I'm thinking, oh, my God, I've got to follow in Russell's steps and not screw this up. That's actually what I was thinking. So this Gary Langford says, I see a flying saucer that landed in the middle of the city. And I thought, well, I don't think so. And besides that, both of us had never been to the Superdome. So I said, would you like to draw that? He made four pictures of domes. He even said, I see grass and cement, and I see no sand traps, so it's not a golf course. I mean, it was amazing, the detail. And then Russell couldn't, I actually did make this talk shorter because I was told to. He even showed where this was in relationship to highways, of the relationship to the highways in the city. He said there was a pattern on the top. It was made out of blown insulation. It was an area where people could go and observe something like a theater. He said there were glass display cases, all true. Just an amazing remote viewing, and I managed to not screw it up. These were the other targets in the pool that were chosen by the outbound experimenter. French Quarter, train atop Lake Pontchartrain Bridge, Causeway, a church in the French Quarter, and this is called the Moonwalk. It's an area where tourists come and you sell knickknacks and so forth. So you see how orthogonal those targets are, and they have to be orthogonal so that you can judge later. If you had four water targets, then you wouldn't know which water target was described, even if it was the person was very sarcastic and described water, which I'll drink some of. Not H2O, dihydrogen oxide, for a change of name. And this is another remote viewing with a Berkeley research group, another in overpass near a freeway, and this is in Berkeley. The subject was Ray Miller, who happened to be rich from finding oil wells. I suspected he might be using some extra stuff. So we did this experiment with him, and this is what he drew. And he said, there's a bunch of cars, and when you look down, you see these cars driving. He said, yeah, I even see some gas guzzlers. This was in the early 80s. And so he said there were flowers and trees around, which was all true, and he described the area very well. This was part of a series that I did north-south. Most of our long distance were east-west, so I did some with Jack Houck. And the target that came up was a biology center at UC Berkeley, the life science building. And it was a whole series of these cages with a little white mice in them. So I went up and put some water in for the mice, and you saw these long cages, and there were men in white lab coats, and this is what the subject drew. He said, I see men in white lab coats, and there's some kind of long structures that I can't make out. He didn't see the mice, and he said there's a loud noise. Well, the whole place was air-conditioned, and it was exceedingly loud. And so this guy was Xianwei Pool, very unexperienced. This was his first series of remote viewing. And he's an engineer at Lockheed Martin. So engineers actually can do other than engineering. You didn't know that, no. Okay, this is Hella Hammert, and Russell was the interviewer. And the target that came up was Macy's. So it wasn't the target pool. Now what we did here is she told my future. She described where I would go before I randomly chose the target. So then I waited in the car. She says, I see a big archway, red bricks, where you can see the white mortar between the bricks. She did draw a cupola that wasn't there. And she and Russell both just zoomed in on this target. It was one of the best descriptions. So I went back. I said to Hella and Russell, well, if you got this part of my future, just tell me the rest and don't leave me in suspense. But they didn't. I don't know why. The other targets in that experiment were a growth center. The underpass could come up. In other words, you could have replacement of targets. And a cement factory. This one, we did come up in one experiment. It wasn't one of my subjects' favorites. They didn't like cement factories. And it is true that, you have to pick uniqueness, but there is something about whether it's pleasant or not. So what I did is I used a developed scale by Russell and to use the judging for a whole bunch of the 80 experiments, but I also used the Princeton 30-point judging technique. So the first one would be excellent correspondence, even naming the place correctly, which is very unusual, but it does happen. Good correspondence and maybe some misinformation. Good with ambiguity and unique features, but not really so close. Good correspondence and several mismatches. About 2.5 is chance. A mixture of correct and incorrect viewing, some correct and not sufficient to say expectation above chance, little correspondence, i.e. wrong, and no correspondence, very wrong. Pretty much almost hard to be completely wrong, because you can say, but you know, there's things like whether it's indoors, outdoors, so you really can delineate pretty well whether the person's at the target. In the case of the Superdome, Russell couldn't go in, but the subject said, he can't go in, but I can, so he described the interior. So here's 80 experiments plotted for real time. Sometimes this works and sometimes it doesn't. Okay. It's just my thumb is getting weak, or it's getting too strong. Anyway, what I plotted is from the 75 to 84, the experiments I did. Okay.
So all you have to do is press this once.
It's okay. Okay, it is. That is so bright that... Notice how it changes color. Can you see? Okay, so what I plotted, this would be the chance expectation line. And unfortunately, I actually got two at chance. But everything else was significant. And some of these were blocks of six experiment. Man, is that bright. I know, my thumb was getting busted on my tree. But anyway, what happened is I plotted the line of the dashed line is a long distance experiment. I think I will see whether the other one will work. I'll keep that in reserve. Don't take it away. You know what, if I had a piece of paper, oh, I know. Maybe this will save my finger. Not too good, but it's good enough. Okay, this line is all these squares fit for all the local experiments within a half hour drive time. This is long distance across country, mostly east-west. And this one is the north-south group that I did 12 experiments with Jack Howe and Shumway Poole. They were both inexperienced, and so they really see there's a learning curve. It's like everything. There's a learning curve, and you can learn to get better at it. And you can get, it's like you get out of practice and back in practice. So reconciling psi with the main body of physics, I was Xeroxing a PhysRev paper. Let's see how that one works. Oh, man. Oh, that's beautiferous. I think we should change the language a bit. What happened is I was Xeroxing this paper, and this guy is, I had given a talk on remote viewing at Berkeley Lab. This guy's pounding on the Xerox saying, I can't deny what you say. I don't think you're lying, but it's denied by the main body of physics. I'm sitting there thinking, I hope he doesn't break the machine before I get the paper, the paper copy. But he didn't break the machine. But I actually spent years looking at how to reconcile psi nonlocality with the main body of physics. And I'll describe a model that I've worked on, and if there's time, I'll describe a little bit about some other models. Okay, if I have space and time, and Minkowski and Einstein said you can't have a space without a time and a time without a space. If we're going to meet for peace, we say where and when. And so we call that the world line, that I am moving in time and I'm also moving in space. So if I take and make a circle, if I get up and make a circle, I have come back to presumably the same place relative to this building and this point on the Earth. But the Earth's rotated, it's gone around the Sun, the galaxy's rotating, and maybe the whole universe is rotating. But the point is that what is relative to what, and how is the next moment in your life actualized? In other words, I may levitate, but the odds of that are relatively small. In fact, quite small. But what it's like going down the freeway, which exit are you going to take? So if I'm moving in space and time, what's my next instance? You know, and it could be all kinds of possibilities. And it's the possibilities getting actualized. determines how we move in space and time. Well, Minkowski and Einstein described it very well with what's called the light cone. And when I gave the first talk on this in about 75, a guy from NASA came up to me and he says, "What's this religious symbol, the light cone?" So this is, oh my God, we have to pray down to it, you know. And it turns out that what it is a way of describing how time and space are connected. This is like X, Y, Z, forward, backwards, sideways, and up. And time is what's on this chronometer, which is a measure by matter and energy changing. It shows that time exists, or we think it does. So every event in the light cone, which just is a description, a mathematical description, should be connected at less than the velocity of light if it has material in it, or at the velocity of light if it's a photon. And that's what Einstein's hypothesis is. But the space like elsewhere of greater than the velocity of light is not precluded by the structure of relativity, but is actually embodied in it. It's just that Einstein said that area is not amenable to our observation of it. But in fact, it is. So here's three examples of past and future not connected. This is the now, and this is a world line which is called single value. Now, if I have multiple world lines, I can go into the future, bring precognitive information into the present. It's only one trouble. I can be at two places at once. And that's called the twin paradox, or the time machine paradox. So by relativity, I can go into the future, but I can't come back into the past in ordinary physics. I have to expand physics, but it turns out the same expansion is in the standard model.
Can I make a comment?
Sure.
This amazing stuff is not New Age stuff that Elizabeth made up. This was understood by Minkowski and Einstein more than 100 years ago.
1905. And actually, Minkowski wrote his big dissertation in 1902. And 1908. It's actually kind of standard stuff. I mean, it's part of the physics religion.
But if you brief that in the wrong venue, people say you're not going to get me to believe anything like that.
It's so funny because do you remember it was at Lalu's house that NASA guy came up after I talked about this. He said, "What's this religious symbol, the light cone, you know?" And you kind of think of a dunce cap, or I mean, you know, it's so interesting, because we're kind of between worlds, but that's exactly where you want to be. You always want to be on the edge. It's more fun. Because, you know, when the skaters go around, the fastest going is on the edge. That's why I drive 100 miles an hour when there's no cops around. I don't want to get that far on the edge. I don't want to get a ticket. So the Minkowski metric, just like E equals mc squared, is the squares of the function. This is the key. It's like a four-dimensional Pythagorean theorem in which the square of the hypotenuse is equal to the sum of the squares of the other two sides of a right triangle. So it's really like space, x, y, z, is three dimensions, and c squared, where that's the velocity of light, actually makes a four-dimensional Minkowski metric, but it's like a four-dimensional Pythagorean theorem. And it really does have to do with the fundamental nature of the structure of space. So I had a dream about it. I thought, how do we reconcile precognition, remote viewing, nonlocality, with the main body of physics? So of course, if I do it in four space, I get closed time-like loops, as I showed. So I could be in this place and this place at the same time. So I said, what if you look down at a higher dimension? Then it looks like a spring, and it's no longer multiply connected. So this is looking down from a higher dimension. So I said, it's got to be a multidimensional geometry. And these are the main principles of physics. Poincaré invariant says, if I do an experiment today in California and a Russian does it next week in the Soviet Union, and now Russia, you'll get the same results if Putin isn't in town. And so that's called Lorentz invariance. It has to do with Bell's theorem, which I'll talk about. See how my time's going. And analyticity is causality. We think of cause-effect. I saw a rock and the glass breaks if I'm throwing it at a window after I throw the rock. But even in particle physics, that's violated to some degree. So then there's unitarity. What that means is a conservation of energy, conservation of quantum mechanical quantities, a conservation of mass. And so when you do psychokinesis, a mind-matter motion, if I remotely affect something with my mind, which is studied in detail by Elizabeth Targ, Russell's daughter, on healing effects, where she studied healing effects, and then Beverly Rubeck and I studied Olga Worrell, and she had amazing healing effects on a model bacteria system of Salmonella typhimurium. And other people, Olga Worrell did a tremendous job. We did, and so did Beverly. It was four major studies over 4 years. But the real one is the bugaboo for physics and force space is precognition, to get future information and bring it back to the now, to process it on a tape recorder and drawings. No cell phones allowed. Okay, so this is a very simplistic view. If I have ordinary space-time, I have the mind-body or physical body idea, and then mind has a domain of action of what's called imaginary components, and I'll explain those in a minute. Now I want you to memorize this slide because you can't read it because it's too small, and there's a pop quiz in the morning. But I also have some figure diagrams which might help. Basically, there is mathematics behind this, enough to fill a whole book called Orbiting the Moons of Pluto by me and Richard Amoroso, World Scientific 2011, and goes into how this evolves new Maxwell's equations, new Dirac equation, new Schrodinger equation, etc. But what I do is the square of a modulus of an imaginary number is a real number. And what an imaginary number is, I equals the square root of a minus 1. And if I have two numbers that are multiplied by each other, if they're both minus, then I get a plus number. But if I have a square root of a minus 1, I can find no real solutions without squaring the function, which is squared in a complex 8 space, which is a double Minkowski space. So I can subtract off real separation between New York and California, remote viewing, by imaginary time, and likewise, I can separate precognition off by access to time dimension. I can separate off by imaginary space. Okay, this is a diagram that may make some sense. Here's time, here's space, and a light cone would look like that. And if I have Russell and his subject in California and I'm outbound in New York, it's a large separation, but if I have access to imaginary time, I can subtract this space off and I can calculate a P3 zero separation. Because when I remote viewing, it's like there's no distance. I actually experience the distant location as though it's on I see it as a screen in front of my face. And I can also, I didn't put that figure in. I solved I've published other papers like on S-matrix theory and particle physics and the Schrodinger equation, Dirac equation, and complex A-space. In Maxwell's equations, I've actually worked on antenna theory. So there is practical application. Engineering, physics, many fields use mathematics, use imaginary numbers, so they're not too far off base because they're part of the fundamental nature of current mathematics. Now, for the second pop quiz, to show you that my theory here is connected to a whole bunch of other guys like Hanselman, Newman, Ellis, and so forth, and Kaluza Klein theory, this complex eight space relates to a complex five space of Kaluza and Klein, who interested Einstein in the 1930s to relate electromagnetism to gravity. The whole idea was to build a unified field theory. And so it shows that there's a whole connection in physics. What are some of the examples of nonlinearity and remote connectedness? Bell's theorem. How many have heard of Bell's theorem? Okay. What it is it says, if I have a decay of a nucleus, I'll put my mouse over here. If I have a source of two photons, like an atomic decay, the two photons go out. Okay, this one's going at the velocity of light, this one's going at the velocity of light. Locality would say there's no correlation. What Jonas Bell formulated from the Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen paradox, that was published in 1935, and Bell in 1964, that if the predictions of quantum mechanics are true, which is of course part of every physicist's religion and belief and even logic, then non-locality has to exist. Now, of course, the physics community was kind of like in the Middle Ages when Kepler drew a radius vector from the sun to the earth. It was like drawing a radius vector from God to an archangel. It was repelled by the church. And it's only recently that this non-locality and what's called quantum entanglement, if two things are correlated at a certain time and they go apart, I twiddle this here and this is affected. Now, actually, they're correlated, and what I think is it's already set up. It's a miscomprehension of space and time. And that's how they explain it. But this is important or more important than the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. How many people know have heard of that? About the same number, okay. Less have heard of that. Well, that's interesting. Heisenberg uncertainty principle says, I can never exactly measure where a thing is and what its momentum is. And this led to huge debates between Niels Bohr, the father of atomic physics, and Einstein. And these guys would walk seriously with their hands behind their back. But really, you're absolutely wrong, because in this Gedanken experiment, which is a thought experiment, this is what happens, and then Einstein would say this and Bohr would say that. Einstein wanted a deterministic world to know where every particle is and hence every law of physics and grok the whole thing. Well, as a kid, I thought maybe if I lived 10,000 years, which is really unlikely, I might be able to grok the whole thing too, but I've kind of gotten to a point which I realize, which is really actually good, the profound ignorance of humans, and myself included. What's good about that is there's all kinds of possibilities, all kinds of potentials, and it's great because it's a lot more fun to have a bunch of stuff to learn than to be bored to death. Okay, Young's double slit experiment is another example of non-locality. And then I worked for many years on plasma instabilities and fusion systems, superfluidity, superconductivity, and of course remote perception. All of these involve non-local phenomena. If I twiddle the universe here, if my outbound experiment experiences this, the laboratory person says this, and they correlate. So this is a diagram of the three experiments, and probably won't go into this, but this has to do with the Bohm-Aronoff experiment. And I expect most of you to know that. I wonder if anybody's heard of the Bohm-Aronoff. Okay. Young's double slit, a source of photons goes through two possible slits and makes an interference pattern on the screen. But if I close one of these, I just get a dot. However, if I have one photon going through one hole or one electron and I have both open, You would think it would only make one dot, but this guy at the screen says, hey, both slits are open, diffract. So who is that guy? And there's a double laser experiment I worked on. This is the Bell Serg setup. And this is an idea I had on laser coherence test of Bell Serg. Hyperdimensional geometry, we have presented a theoretical model to elucidate how psi phenomena, the attribute of consciousness that we call psychic, relates to the main body of physics. And it's as though everything is a vast web of particles that remain in contact with each other over any distances and in no time. And this one, I won't give you a pop quiz, but the point is, this is a whole bunch of different aspects of the standard model and what's called the grand unification models, or gut models, or theory of everything called the tone models. Now, when a person has a theory of everything, I kind of really would sort of stay away from them, because they'd be pretty dogmatic. You know, and it wouldn't be much fun when you go out for pizza at the space-time continuum. Okay, but my complex theory is part of this whole picture. In other words, 5 and 6, my work is integrated through the Penrose twister and the spinner calculus. So that's hypermathematics and fun to play with. Stuff that I get off on it. It is not as old as psi is not as old as mankind, but gravity is older, and it took Newton and Einstein and others to realize its existence and to be able to describe it by a set of equations. Einstein said it's the curvature of space-time that creates gravity around massive objects. A study of the properties of consciousness then too may bring about a new era in human concepts, a deeper understanding of the fundamental nature of reality. Perfect, because of course I know everything about reality. Oh, you can get after me on that one. Here's the way I see physics. It drew a line of external reality. What you know in the mind is the subject of what you think is going on. I draw this nature of reality around the mind, include the mind in physics and all of science. And in fact, I would ask my grad students at the accelerator, what's your purpose in doing this experiment? To impress mom and dad, to get a degree and maybe study physics, or maybe impress somebody, maybe impress your girlfriend. We all have motives, we all have purpose. And you can't divide that out of whatever endeavor you do. What we perceive as reality depends on the assumptions and state of consciousness. Barriers are useful, like saying a chair is different from a table, and artificial constructs of the mind. What is real and must necessarily include the aspect of mind reality as well as what is called external reality to be complete or unified. In a sense, when we include the mind's knowledge and structure in our description of reality, we find our perception appears to become dramatically unbounded with new aspects of possibilities. So it's like what's happened in modern science is to look at the islands, physics, biology, psychology, and so forth. But there's a fundamental underlying unity under the ocean surface. Well, what should we do? I want to optimize psi, the social implications of psi, the social implications of psi for education, for understanding the mind, body, spirit, which are really unified, which JJ and Desiree will talk more about. Psi and self-healing and healing others, implication of psi for education, health and creativity, philosophy, society, and a new peaceful, joyful version of life. It is possible to exist human emanations that are still unknown to us. Do you remember how electrical currents and unseen waves laughed at. The knowledge of man is still in its infancy, Albert Einstein. And he was talking about psychic phenomena. There is no unnatural or supernatural phenomena, only large gaps in our knowledge of what is natural. We should strive to fill these gaps of ignorance. Edgar Mitchell, astronaut, Apollo 14. He's a swell, really swell guy. The wise man looks into space and does not regard the small as too little, nor the great as too big, for he knows that there is no limit to dimension. And that is it. This is a book that I, the physics book that I wrote, and this is our upcoming joint work with Drs. J.J. and Desiree Hurtak, Mind Dynamics in Space and Time, a Physicist's View of the Nature and Properties of Consciousness. So we're almost done with it. We probably have one more day of proofing, and then if there's any errors in it, it means it's real, because to be real, everything is imperfect because we have no completeness on the physical plane. The only completeness is the whole of reality and existence much beyond the physical plane. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Elizabeth. We're going to be moving on with continuing some of that information on non-locality.
I wanted to say that Astronaut Mitchell is in the hospital as of this time, so send your positive energy to Astronaut Mitchell. He's in a critical state. He was responsible, as you know, for some of the work at SRI with Uri Geller and my beloved colleague Andre Puharic. I have worked with him in other capacities, but his work and his experiments from outer space are something that underscore what we would call a new definition of where we're going with futurism. We are basically defining a cosmology of consciousness, a new image of humanity, which could be called a realization that we are a cosmoplanetary anthropology subject. We are multidimensional beings, and as the work of Russell Targ, Harold Pudoff, and others have shown, we are also non-local beings with tremendous gifts and powers. And so Desiree and I would like to take a few minutes to show you the complementary side of what we've been working on in terms of the other aspects of where we go from this point forth.
Right. So we're going to be talking now about our topic, which is future science and science guided by consciousness. And of course, this really dovetails what Elizabeth just talked to us about. And we do want to start with the concept of non-locality. I know most of you are familiar with it, but non-locality is a phenomenon that implies a direct influence of one object on another distant object, independent of the distance between them, so fast that no information could have traveled between them. And this is actually a paper that Russell and Elizabeth did of that the shaking, as she was showing you, were changing from one spin to another at distances apart, was faster than the speed of light. That's what we're going to be showing you, some of the research that took place.
Some of the, going back to 1935 with Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen, going through Bell's theorem that we all know has some other aspects that Elizabeth is going to be attending to. The Clauser research facility team in 1969, and of course, more recently, the work of Nicholas Giessen at the University of Geneva. We are working also in Switzerland, where we are closely in touch with many of the research groups.
And Giessen and also Salat have been doing probably some really hands-on experiments in the area of Geneva, as Dr. Hurtak mentioned. So here's Salat's experiment in 2008, and you can find this in the physical review letters. So they performed an experiment where you can see very clearly, I'm going to show you another picture as well, where they used literally communication connected with Swisscom from Geneva. They split the photon into two, sent one to one of the French towns and another to Jussé, which is 18 kilometers apart. And during the Salat experiment, the reaction took 7.1 microseconds, which is significantly less than the 60 microseconds it would take a photon to cover the 18 kilometers between the two analyzers.
1/10,000th the speed of light, according to their research. This is also published in Physical Review Letters for 2008, as I said before. But though a large, substantial database is being built now by leading physicists and researchers worldwide. What do we see here in the next?
Well, this is actually directly from Gishin's PowerPoint work that he's showing what they were able to do. This is an amazing, you can kind of really see it laid out, and that the change of, we'll say, the direction of the photon was almost instantaneously reacted to by the other one 18 kilometers apart. It gives you like a real perspective of what people are talking about. And this is showing, again, of course, non-locality. I just saw also that Gishin has occasionally a conferences up in Geneva where Alain Expect and others come and do these talks and talk about it. So
no signal of any kind was transmitted between the photons, but despite this, one of the photons knew what was happening to his distant twin. That is, it was a mimic, really, the twin response that we all have thought about.
Specifically, the patterns changed as the investigators adjusted both analyzers, interferometers to alter the phase of the photons and measure how in step they were. But the nature of the changes in the interference patterns showed that no matter how the phase was adjusted, each photon knew the phase of its twin at 18 kilometers apart. This is what's, and so what really this is saying to everyone is in quantum physics, spatially separated systems are not logically separated. They're just not that. Quantum physics, that's where people are looking for this, is showing that there's non-locality or non-local. And Bell's paper showed that no local classical model could duplicate the correlation seen in quantum systems. Now, some people are looking, and I think Elizabeth's done a fantastic job of not only talking about quantum mechanics, but actually, in a sense, classical physics, when she takes it to another level that she just touched on. I think you should have even touched on more of her complex eight space.
And this is another situation because of the time and because of this is the jewels. A physicist, I side with Elizabeth, we just have only so much time to compress vast information. But essentially, what I hinted at with astronaut Mitchell is something that really needs to be emphasized, his experiments in outer space, to Earth, to two sensitives, Ingalls Swan being one, and Harold Sherman being the other. There was a third person yet to be named, but essentially he showed with the Apollo 14 mission, turning off technology, how mind could target people on Mother Earth with precise signals.
Right, but in a sense, it's not signaling. We're so used to sending and receiving. I mean, that's what we're always thinking about. We're sending a signal, we're sending something out, and we're getting feedback back. And scientists are telling us right now, that's not what's happening. Something else is happening. Something else is connected. And one of the things we can talk about in the questions and answers session is, you know, can you change that? What happens if you see something that you don't like? Can you change it, and do you change it from this reality, or do you change it from another reality? This is just some ideas we'd like to put
So what is up. One of the bottom lines? It means that communication is instantaneous with no delay and may be an explanation for the discipline we call remote viewing.
Right, so we're talking about photons, and we're seeing it in photons, but then Elizabeth Rauscher and Russell Targ are showing us in terms of the mind as well. Well, that's not really photons, but is there a correlation? Of course, we think that there is. So what we are saying is that quantum physics works through a quantum interactions that seem to be to interconnect everything in the universe in some capacity. And this is what the work of really Elizabeth Rauscher is.
In her complex eight space.
To identify how and that connects. How is non-locality functioning in our reality and where in our reality?
We see a connection between the microsystem double helix DNA within our body and the macrosystem double helix nebula, as it is called in space, seen by the very sophisticated probes.
Right, so what we're saying as well is that there may be some sort of interconnection of all reality in third dimensional space, but maybe it comes from or is working with other dimensions. And this is really what scientists are starting to look at as.
Well, could we say poetically, we are as much in space as space is within us? We are a membrane between a macro and microsystems.
But I think what we also have to say is what scientists are starting to look at, like the Kaluza-Klein or the Calabria-Yau manifold, is that it's not all happening here. It's not all happening in third and fourth dimensional space. I think that's the most important thing that is we're kind of introducing. And scientists with string theory or membrane theory are introducing that it's not all happening in this reality. It's what is reality? Good question. But it's happening in other dimensions as well. Now, many scientists want to like put them into little manifolds and lead to the idea of mirror symmetry, but maybe these dimensions are as powerful, as large, or even larger than the reality we're seeing here. Just an idea.
Algebraic geometry is this one little phase of putting your toe into the cosmic all space. So we're seeing something here that is a unique understanding of geometry, but not sufficient in the long run.
Well, yes, that's just a model, and it was a
great model. So the question is, does quantum physics and consciousness answer the question of remote viewing? Stuart Hameroff, for example, states that the phenomena such as telepathy can be explained by quantum entanglement, which are inherently non-local. The trick is to show how two people become entangled, but as we are seeing, implying fundamental space-time geometry, it may be inherently non-local. And so our sense of spatial separation may be somewhat illusory.
Now, we wrote a book with, or Dr. Hurtak, I should say, wrote a book with Russell Targ that says, it's called End of Suffering. And the idea is because a lot of our own suffering comes from our sense of separation. And if you get rid of that notion of separation and know that even if someone's on the other side of the planet or on another, we'll say, passed away, that there still can be that connection. We know that there's that connection on the other side of the planet. We're not quite as sure on other realities if someone's passed away. But the idea is that this becomes much more all-encompassing. Remote viewing is just the way of showing the reality of these things. And this experiments with Gishan and Sralat are just showing that. But you
historically, the mystics that could put their head beyond the veil of space-time had perhaps a peek at what we're beginning to understand in a poetic sense. The process of awakening begins only when we ourselves are conscious to question life from the standpoint of our five senses. Peering out into the greater evolutionary realm, we begin to experience the first phase of our initiation process. That is to realize that we are part of a consciousness plenum. We are not localized simply as planetary beings. We are multidimensional beings, waking up in a vast and awesome universe.
So what's that universe? That's the real question. What's the nature of our universe? And what is reality? So
Parmenides said, the universe is a plenum. That is, there are no gaps, no voids, no space where there is nothing. Everything has something at work.
And that might be the way we need to start looking at things. Some people have looked at the holographic universe, where each part is part of every part. But actually, Hogan from Fermilab has just tried to do some testing about a two-dimensional reality, and he has not been able to show that. But that doesn't completely rule out the concept that each part may be part of every part. He may just have been looking
at it. As many of you know, this was largely the work of Carl Prebram and his associates. The holographic universe model seems to be stretching, really, for the most part. Nonetheless, it was a very interesting point of dialogue. And Desiree and have looked at this also from the standpoint of ancient mystical literature, both in the Far East and the Near East.
Right, and we've also written papers with Elizabeth Rauscher, although she's a little bit saying we haven't proven it yet, about the multiverse. That, and this is one of the pictures really from Scientific American, showing that, you know, we're just our whole universe, the entire universe with the billions and billions of stars, that some scientists say that the grains of all the grains of sand in this world really is not as much as the stars in our universe. So this would be our universe, just right here. And so there's all the possibilities of all the other universes. So you can see how, really, in this day and age, we'll say the 21st century, we're starting to expand our knowledge. Not only that we are non-local in terms of being able to use remote viewing, but we may be part of a much more vast universe if we take ourselves out of the center. And that's always been a very difficult thing.
What we call membranes of divine world. Behind the codes, behind emanations, and light behind the light, or science behind myth and myth behind science.
So we want to acknowledge David Bohm also. And Elizabeth, you met him, right? You spent some time with him?
I taught at the University of London Physics Department with Bohm and Hiley. And he was terrific.
Yeah, so she actually met David Bohm.
One of Desiree's favorites.
Yeah.
So Miles Hiley also.
So we not only want to talk about nonlocality, of how the universe shows a spooky interconnectedness, according to Einstein, but Bohm's implicate order, where there is a universal wave field and intelligent information. So that could be a way of analyzing this, and we've always liked his theory. He says, in addition to that, that there exists a continuous field, the plenum, that the whole field is the original quantum wave with a super field for information. And that's the implicate order. That's like underlying everything that we have. And then he takes that into an explicate order, which is where we are. But he says that there is an underlying cosmic intelligence establishing the whole process as a closed loop. Now, this is a scientist. Maybe it's a little far out in terms of going into some philosophical notions, but we do believe that there is this underlying field, whether it's something we don't see or whether it's in another dimensional reality, that there is that field. So we kind of like to support his research as a background for what...
So we have a picture of Desiree design here concept of the flow of expanded consciousness. Here, quantum physics is the kind of code that interconnects everything in the universe. And thoughts is part of the interconnection with the greater quantum field.
So that gets into really the idea of remote viewing, that we are really biotransducers. This is something that Dr. Hurtak's been saying for about 40 years, that our brain can put information into the field, but we can also receive information from the field.
The problem is we get stuck in some area of abstract physics, mathematics, or even theology. We miss really the common ground that links the two. Consciousness evolution and what I call scientific evolution meet at a point of futurism in the now, where we realize that we are custodians of the whole spectrum of knowledge and wisdom. It's not limited to the elitist few who play a game of what I will call pride parasitism, where their thoughts dominate the whole dialogue process. No, there's a whole humanistic side of realizing the interplay between mind, body, and spirit, and that we define this in terms of the greater consciousness. We believe that the human body, and especially the brain, work as a network in its connection with consciousness throughout the body, and also the body politic.
So now we're going to take a moment to talk about a book that Dr. Hurtak and Russell wrote. We had three copies in the back, but you can also download it, which most people would prefer probably
and
nowadays.
This was illustrated
Mary
by the great Ingo Swann. And Elizabeth and we have dedicated our new book to Ingo Swann.
Right.
His beautiful picture here shows really the opening of the mind, like an egg, seeing the galaxies, whirling galaxies within the mind's eye, and how we can expand to a new frontier with the higher gifts of remote viewing, remote communication, and remote healing.
So with Russell here, we're just going to talk a little bit. I think, Russell, you want to say just one word about this kind
of... One of your favorite areas with Hal Puthoff in South America and Colombia.
Yes, this is one of my favorite remote viewings because it was the first one that I did myself. We're doing a series of remote viewings with the great Pat Price, and each day he would describe what it looked like where our colleague Hal was hiding someplace in South America. And we did five like that, and then on day six, Pat Price didn't show up. So I'm sitting in my little shielded booth, little telephone booth covered with copper. I say, this is a remote viewing with Russ Targ and Pat Price, and Pat hasn't come. So in the spirit that the show must go on, I'll do it myself. So I made the drawing on the lower right, and I said, what I see is something like an island airport, an airport building on the left, sand and grass on the right, an ocean at the end of the runway. And that's 100% of my drawing. That was it. That took about 5 minutes. The following week, Hal came back, and he had been at the airport at San Andreas, and this is a photograph of where he was located. Well, so the important thing about this experiment is not my particular psychic prowess, but it shows something about remote viewing. The remote viewing is so easy that even a scientist can do it.
Russell,
that was
you were
Columbia,
very
Columbia.
Right on. You can see the details of the side area connected with the terminal, the grassy area,
and
of course the
ocean.
The geometry of the landing strip is important here.
So this is in the book. The next one is not, but we've always had this as one of our favorite ones. And what we didn't realize is that what you're looking at, or who you're looking at here,
is Elizabeth throwing the paper airplane to David Hertz. Miss Mullins is not in the picture, but she's taking the picture. What we have here is a very interesting area of Palo Alto. Picture's taken October 30th, 1976.
Maybe Elizabeth wants to say something.
Remote viewer is able to pick up on a fountain and also a golden circular ring in this concrete depression area with artificial flowers.
I think my mic is still on. This was Susan Harris at the time, a pre-med student, and she was a friend of Russell's. And so it was me, Dave Hurt, and Audrey Mullins, Hope Mullins, outbound, and gosh, she even got the seven. See how there's a on the building, it looks like an upside seven over there. And she said there's windows everywhere. She just was so accurate, and she said, an object is being thrown and comes by Dave Hurt. See, I'm throwing it to Dave Hurt. It's just really, her description. And then the fountain in the lower part, there were three of us. And then she says it's like water blooming out of a fountain, but it's not really working. And I see like yellow, orange, flower-like things. And those lights in the fountain were yellow, orange, had yellow, orange surface.
I think she said also looks like a bonsai tree, or was that some other experiment?
That was another experiment.
But this is going to be one in the upcoming book, Mind Dynamics.
What we see here, of course, is that the paper airplane is in motion. So the concept here is not simply a static reality check, but something showing something in motion. That's even more important.
And that's why we want to just take a moment to show this from the Hawaii remote viewing group. Now you actually see, here's a photo was held in a sealed envelope by a skeptic as part of a test. And then the person actually who's remote viewing this is able to see the person in motion.
Bungee cord.
Yeah, amazing that even motion can be seen. This is more difficult, but I think one of the most amazing things has always been where, and they did this with Pat Price and Ingo Swann, they gave them just a north and southeast west coordinate, like longitude and latitude. And they immediately were able to go there without the logical thinking, oh, it's going to be in Russia or it's going to be in South America. They just used the coordinate to remote view the place. And that, to me, is unreal. But it worked many, many times.
Who
go
is
ahead.
The viewer here? Who made that remarkable drawing?
Yeah, no, this, well, Dick. It's from the, Dick A, they're just using, from the Hawaii remote.
Dick Elger.
Oh, thank you. Well, anyway, and how to put that in, because it is a remarkable drawing.
Some of you know we do quite a bit of archaeological research in the world, and one of our areas has been in Egypt, where we have been able to go underneath the Giza Plateau and uncover a series of rooms. And I was there a few years ago giving a lecture at the university there in Cairo, and I asked Elizabeth to tune in. I didn't give her any details. I said at a certain time of day, tune in to me, and not only she was able to pick up, you see here in her sketchbook, the four of us walking, and the security guard is behind us because of the terrorist threat, but on the lamp poles. And these are unusual lamp poles because they are embellished at the top and bottom by a type of foliation. You can see this with this laser beam I'm pointing to. She picked up not only on the shape of the light lamp, the pole, but also the foliation at the top and bottom, which I thought was quite remarkable.
And she also saw this unusual blue, and actually the doorway over here is like one of those like metal rusty things, and so it comes out blue.
So this will be in our new book, along with other pictures, where I went underground. She was able to pick up on that. Also, by a lost pyramidal formation, she was able to pick up in Desiree and I with no information. So, as Russell would say to the Russians, there's no secret information. Everything is public.
I just want to say, in terms of...
We live in a public schoolhouse on Mother Earth. Everything is there. If we use the right consciousness, we can tap into not only the volumes, but if we're clever enough, perhaps we can see inside some of the names and some of the descriptions.
So, you know, Russell does some great learning sessions for people to start understanding how to do remote viewing. And I think the first thing he says is don't rationalize it, just the first thing that comes into your mind. So I want to take a minute to talk about Dick Behrman's experiment at the University of Amsterdam, where he established two observers. Observer two was asked to determine if an event had consciously been observed by observer one. Now, observer two was not asked to make a conscious observation, but Behrman sought to determine if the brain, so he looked at the brain of observer two, could unconsciously make the determination. He established an EEG electrode to determine different signals within the brain of observer two. His results showed that really a great, less than, I should say, 0.2 determination beyond chance.
0.02.
That the observer two was able to somehow react to the greater quantum field. So the brain is picking up on it. He didn't even have to ask the guy to say yes or no. He picked it up in the brain. That is an amazing test that he was able to do. So we're all tuning in. This is something
that... So the spin-offs of remote viewing are in areas of archaeology, geology, neurology, and obviously all of the social sciences. So there's a tremendous wealth of information here. The case studies at SRI have opened up basically the emperor's jewels to a vast avalanche of new possibilities, as we see here in diagrams from the Far East and the Near East. In the Egyptian traditions, the hands raised above the head represent reaching for higher wisdom or knowledge of the Ka through the over-self that is awakened. In the Buddhistic tradition, in pre-Buddhistic tradition, you have the multiple heads representing the multiple bodies of the perceptual apparatus that can have omnidirectionality in all dimensions as they, in that cultural tradition, would define it. And also illustrated through unique of colors, but also miniature hands representing different doors of consciousness.
So now we're going to look at this really short clip called Newsy. It's very quick, but it's also showing the power of the mind, of how in science and also ultimately in medicine, that we can use the mind to raise and change realities of physical objects. Now, we know this from PK. This is actually more technological. It's more
Silicon Valley. This was worked out at the University of Minnesota just a couple years back.
But it's showing how we're developing in a whole new way. And, you know, I know that Beverly Rubik's going to be here in a couple months, and I hope you watch her. But one of the ways I tell people to start training in remote viewing is before you answer that cell phone, to think who it is. And I know Rupert Sheldrake's done some great research on this with very, very high incidence of accuracy, especially amongst family members, that you really, I mean, how many people here have known who's calling them before they look? Come on, almost everyone. So I think the cell phone has been a great way of introducing all of us to remote viewing.
We were 40 kilometers away from ISIS in South Syria. We didn't know we were doing archaeological work. I felt Beverly very strong. Beverly and Harry were very strong in my consciousness. But I felt from my friends who knew I was going on this mission that there would be, quote unquote, consciousness field protection. And we have to realize we're living in serious sociological times that require a positive outreach. And how can we do this? Realize that we're part of the action. Not through military arms, but through the power and consciousness of the, what I will call the feminine principle within us, the compassionate side, the higher side of unconditional love, and the artistic side of seeing how images, particularly those with color and sound, can blend in into landscapes of reconciliation and reversal of negativity.
Right, so this is more technological, but I think it's a very interesting piece, so let's see if it comes on.
Remote controlled helicopters, you'll soon be old news. Minnesota researchers have now made it possible to control the mini flyers with your thoughts. Mind control, people. Mind control.
Place an electric sensor over the scalp of human subject, and we train the subject to ask them to imagine certain movement action with intention of control the flight.
So the controller doesn't actually move at all. It's all in the head. They do say the human brain is a powerful place, but it all really comes down to two words, the force. But really, nature.com breaks down the inner workings.
Specific neurons in the brain's motor cortex produce electric currents. These currents are detected by electrodes in an EEG cap, which sends the signals to the computer.
The computer then translates the signals into a command like turn right and sends it to the robot via Wi-Fi. It then turns right. And in case you were wondering, this futuristic invention isn't hitting store shelves to become playthings for kids anytime soon. The mind-controlled copter was actually created for a much different purpose. According to the lead professor, this brain-computer interface technology is all about helping people with a disability or various neurodegenerative diseases to help them regain mobility, independence, and enhance performance. Now the question is, what else will we soon be able to control with our minds? Lunch, come to me. Well, one can dream. For Newsy, I'm Jasmine Bailey.
So I love that because it's showing that just by setting up the EEGs around that you're able to literally control the movement. I mean, they just do it by Wi-Fi, but just by thinking, just by visualizing, you're able to make a movement and a change. Fantastic stuff that we're starting to find out really about ourselves. So every single one of us also has free will and input into the quantum field as far as we're concerned. We're going to not go too much longer. Maybe one other thing, beyond the circuitries of our body and mind, we enter higher dimensions of thought form creativity and operate as one with the eternal mind of the I Am. That's our thoughts, because we think that there is a universal mind, a global mind, that we can connect to. Just a few final thoughts on quantum power or quantum spirit.
Consciousness is the force which first entangles and acts on most of our neurobiological physiology through these quantum mechanical processes. This brings us to the notion of quantum computing. Of course, Richard Feynman entertained this back in 86 within the brain, where it may not be that the brain has fixed or not fixed as we have been traditionally been told, but there exist certain states which state A and B, as well as the superimposition of A and B in a coherent state. That is to say, operate until once state A or B is chosen or reduced.
So this is one of the things that I'm sure some of you are familiar with, Stuart Hameroff and Roger Penrose, who feel that we are kind of transducing the quantum field, that all the possibilities are up there. We're going to show that in a minute. Let me just actually jump to that because of our time. So according to Bohm and to Penrose, the plenum is made up of the superposition of many possibilities as part of the implicate order. And so how does thought work? There exists the possibility that there are many worlds or simply many possibilities. And this is important on a personal level that, you know, I say you can get up in the morning and think all the negative thoughts. I don't have enough money. I don't have time for a vacation. Or you can change your thoughts and reduce the other ones with, I'm doing fine. I'm going to take time out for a vacation. It's all what you choose, because all the possibilities, and that's part of quantum fields that are quantum mechanics, that all the multiple possibilities are there, and you're the one reducing what you choose to have.
So we use a good selective factor to take the positive upper path, if possible.
So it's the observer who collapses the many superpositions of multiple realities into the one. Here, superpositions are important because it means there are many possibilities available in the universe of which we can choose the reduction. So in addition to sending and receiving, well, it's not even signaling, it's not even sending and receiving, in connecting to other parts of the planet, we can also connect to other thoughts in our reality.
So what is the bottom line? Although the majority of people just want to think negative, be part of the 2% that want to think positive at all times. And that translates into sociological and cultural dialogue that goes places. We've used this in South Africa prior to the end of the apartheid, working with different tribal groups, thinking positive, using higher states of consciousness to open new dialogue through artistic symbols. Science, as much as we like it in the traditional modality, is way up there in the ethers. But to bring this down into practical usage requires a language of compassion. And here, humanism connects with the new sciences.
So Bohm believed that the individual participant appendage, I think it's supposed to be, participates in the whole and consequently gives it meaning. Because the human participation, the implicate order is getting to know itself better. The individual is also in total contact with the implicate order. So you actually know more than what is in front of you or what you've been told or what you've been taught. You have that extra possibility.
This is a series of the cosmograms we created to get the mind to expand and to see multiple realities simultaneously through a language of color, sound, and conceptuality.
And I'm just going to say that the brain is part of that entangled whole. This is what Elizabeth was connecting with. And also different frequencies seem to make a difference. And you're familiar with this about the gamma, beta, alpha, theta, delta. But there's been some great research done. Here's the University of Tübingen in Germany, where they actually played a certain frequency music during the night so that the brain could remember more. So even the brain itself, in sound frequencies, are certain, this is beyond sound technically, it's 0.8 hertz, slow oscillations, that the participants were better able to recall the words that they learned the day before. They also tested the effects of music stimulation when it was not in sync with the brain's slow oscillation activity and found that memory was not improved. So even just the very frequency of the brain and sounds around you and certain oscillating rhythms actually can enhance or not enhance memory.
This is called the Klang Project. Vera Brandes is one of the top musicologists that we've been working with. In the past, she's worked with Tangerine Dream and some of the musical groups throughout the world. And so this is a whole new phase of utilizing what we call the background soundscape that is focused into making decisions for the positive side of life.
So in closing, we want to talk about something that all of you should know, but it's also important to remember.
We all remember the work of Dr. Emoto from Japan, the beautiful crystals that he was able to observe under certain conditions.
And we're made up of something like 65 to 75% water, depending on your age and probably how much you drink too. And the idea is that with positive thoughts, you can literally help enhance your body. With negative thoughts, you can change that water into something that's really ugly. So even putting that out to one another or to put it even within yourself, depending on the thoughts that you choose. And just a little overview of what he showed. These are all different ways of the water crystal for those who haven't seen his
complimentary medicine.
Right, this is Lourdes water, and if you're not familiar, it's frozen at minus 25 degrees centigrade and observed and photographed under a microscope in room temperature at minus 5 degrees centigrade. So this is from Lourdes, top right after letting water here. This is from like certain types of heavy metal music. And then the not great. And water crystal after wrapping a vial of water with the words love and thanks in Japanese characters. Doesn't matter what characters you're using. So even Japanese is one thing. The middle is with wrapping the vial of water with the words the devil. And then finally with the song of Moldau, of positive music.
So the mental language has, as it one of its connections, a type of musical algebra. And this is a whole new area that German, Japanese, and other groups are looking at now. And if you're interested, we can put you in touch with some of the work we've done with Carlos Santana, who has changed the lives of tens of thousands of young people, moving away from heavy metal music to that which is conducive to cross-cultural understanding. In conclusion, we're looking at the new sphere, ideas that have been put forth by the great philosophers. But the fine-tuning of this really comes down to the role that we take. Here we expand this into the understanding of universal knowledge and universal intelligence that exists, and that we are interconnected with it. We are connected with all space. We are connected with all humanity. This is our credo, but God is also a verb. And so the credo is an action.
And my motto is, if thoughts become things, make sure you choose the good ones.
And finally, from the cosmogram, we are multidimensional beings. There are many planes of experience. If we choose to remain Earth lovers, we can stand on one or two dimensional space. But if we open up our consciousness, we can begin to see and evaluate there are other tremendous possibilities. We see at the top of the cosmogram the dove that represents in historic cultures the symbol of universal communication and spiritual unfoldment. And so as we demythologize and go to the science behind the science, the myth behind the myth, we begin to realize we are all truly interconnected as sparks of the divine.
And we live in a consciousness universe.
We thank you.
So we're here for some questions and answers, of course, and we hope this book will be out in April, probably the latest. It's been a long time coming. It is a lot of Elizabeth Rauscher's work, a little bit of the work she's done with us, and we've written some things connected with the work that we were involved with also in the 70s till and present. So I hope everyone can tune into that at futurescience.org is one of our main websites. And so we want to open it up for questions.
The gentleman over here on my left.
Elizabeth, turn around.
Elizabeth.
I need to somehow
get yourself around here. Put this in.
Okay. Could you address our
be happy to. Team? So a while back I made a presentation, I referred to Mandela and Lingle's book, Wrinkle in Time. You guys have heard about that one?
You know Wrinkle in Time, Elizabeth?
Yeah, I've heard it.
I thought you might. Okay, so in the book she refers to a concept where you short define as a tesseract. I looked it up in Wikipedia, which is not anything but an authentic source. And sure enough, you know, they had references to what looks like mid-eight space.
We can't hear.
You've been muffled.
Eight space.
So Madeline Lingle's book, A Wrinkle in Time, is a reference to a thing called the tesseract.
Still can't hear you louder.
Okay. So we have a little problem here with the acoustics.
In front of this, it's going to cause a problem. Go for it. Okay, Madeline Lingle's book, A Wrinkle in Time, has a reference to a thing called a tesseract. It's a kid's book. I read it a long time ago. And if you look it up in Wikipedia, there are references to mathematical diagrams talking about eight space. Now, I'm not a mathematician. Is there really a correlation there that she struck on, right? Do you know anything about that? Is there any bells with you?
I do. I know about the book. And the tesseract is really a representation of four space, but from a fifth dimensional perspective. Or actually, it's a three space with a four dimensional. It's constructed very differently from my complex A space, and her space does not contain non-locality. It's a different geometry.
I just want to add that talking to Elizabeth, she believes eight space is the minimal space needed for the connection of the sun.
Yeah, it's a subspace of a larger 12 space that I've worked on. And what it does is it obeys Lorentz invariance or the conditions of physics and has non-locality. But there are other geometries that are possible. And hers is does not contain non-locality.
How are you spelling that word?
Non-locality or eight space?
Tesseract.
Tesseract.
Tesseract. Tesseract. Tesseract. I got a follow-up question there.
It's a representation of a four spatial dimensional cube.
So I walked up to Jessica Utz, 2007 Urban Bench, I said, how is it that we're able to do what we do? She says, you know, I'm not really sure. Nobody can answer that. You're the first person. One of the people I talk to and know about that. Russell has an idea, too. He said, go read the book Flatland by Ed. What's that name?
Abbott,
yeah. And I read it and went, okay, it's graphical. It's three-dimensional. And it helped, but it didn't quite do it. I didn't know about your work. I knew about you, okay? I actually have a page on Facebook called Non-Local Consciousness, okay? So this is interesting.
Well, it's so interesting to me because a whole group of us that worked in the 70s and 80s, all getting weird contact and touch with each other. It's a long way to go to make peace, love, and joy out of war, crime, and violence. But we're on the path.
Director,
a lot of people.
So let's take a question from Joe here.
Yes, this seems like to me a non-scientist, a very complex process. I'm wondering if there are any teachers or groups, either online or locally, that one could go to for help in dealing with this, in doing the remote viewing, and especially in being able to help the pain of oneself or other people.
Yes, Russell has done some work, and he might know some groups that
especially
are all remote viewing.
Anything local?
No, it's very, I know people who are teaching remote viewing. If you wanted to go learn remote viewing, Paul H. Smith, who's now in Salt Lake City, is a very experienced remote viewer, been teaching for years and years. Now, secret is, if you go to Google, you'll find 500,000 pages devoted to remote viewing. And that's because remote viewing is a natural ability, and it's so easy to teach that anybody who starts learning remote viewing says, that's fantastic, I could teach that. And there are many, many, many people teaching remote viewing. Some of them are psychic, some of them are not. But because if you have somebody who just set your training wheels in the groove and give you a push to give you the experience, it's easy to do. I've taught workshops with dozens of people who have never done it before, and they had very good outcomes.
So some questions over here. We'll take one from the back because it's been a little bit. Okay, I'll give one.
I was wondering if superstring theory or M theory is compatible with nonlocality.
Yes.
So completely.
Yes, it doesn't deny nonlocality. And string theory comes from the idea of treating a particle as a finite vibrating string, because if I have a singularity as a dot for an atom or a nucleus or a particle, then I get infinities and I have to subtract other infinities off. So I started with Benziano when I was at Lawrence Berkeley in the 70s. And no, it's not in conflict with nonlocality. It is compatible.
And brain theory as well.
And brain theory.
And also the work of Schwartz at Feldtech.
Thank you.
And I'll say Lisa, also from Harvard.
Lisa Randall. Yeah, Lisa Randall's book on warp passages is a good book too. It's written for the general person. What is a general person? Oh, they're all specific and general at the same time.
They used to have at the University of Minnesota what was called the NMPI, which was to seek out the average person. That sort of proved to me it's somewhat farcical because we began to realize that those who devised the program, those who were involved with the testing, realized that that was a very arbitrary reduction, and life is not that way.
So we'll take another three questions maybe. Here's Joyce.
Hi, I studied at Monroe Institute with remote viewing with Skip Atwater and Joe McMonagle.
Good teachers.
Very good teachers. And one of the things that came up was how with any tool it could be used in a very positive way, or it could be used against us in a negative way. And I'm curious, I've been around a lot of people who have gotten threatened for their work in these arenas, and I'm wondering if you have any advice, any suggestions, and any stories related. Thank you.
Maybe I can start with that, although we have everyone talking. I say one thing, we have to choose the thoughts. The thought can go there, like I could send something to Russell, but he has to choose to receive it, and I think if he doesn't choose to receive the negative, he's protected. So I think, you know, we should always send positive energy, and we've done work for peace. We did it with Andrea Pujarik, that's in the book. But ultimately, we make that claim that people, you need to take control of your own thought forms. You need to, you know, be in charge of them, but you also need to start working with the positive thoughts
like
and not
to
the
give
negative.
A quick story.
Okay.
Then Russell. Yeah. I was at a big conference on death and dying. Of course, it should be dying and death, because I think you're dying before you're dead. And all of a sudden, I had this overwhelming theory, feeling of fear. But I knew it wasn't mine. It was a woman a couple of chairs up. And I thought, you have to choose. And Russell's key is you have to tell the truth. And as long as you tell the truth and you choose, it's just like I wouldn't go to some neighborhood. I'm not going to Syria. These guys can go to Syria, but I'm staying at home. And you choose. So you choose at the physical, but you choose at the psychic at all the other planes.
Russell?
Yeah.
I just like to have a simple idea. If I invented a drop of very pure water, and use a drop of water to nourish the world and to feed the thirsty, or you could use it to drown your enemy. No matter what new thing appears in the world, no matter how beautiful or how benign, if it occurs in the world, then people are going to use it in concurrence with their own beliefs.
Yes.
Elizabeth, can I say a word about the eight space model?
Sure.
I'd like to try and say three sentences about the eight space model to let it seem less complicated than it is. The eight space model is really very simple. We're all familiar with the four space model in which we live. There are three space dimensions and one time dimension. Everybody has an idea about that? Those are the four dimensions. Now Elizabeth's idea was that if you look at each of those four dimensions, now, her idea was we need more space. You look around, and there are many people who say, let's have more dimensions. Adding more dimensions makes things very complicated for a variety of reasons. Elizabeth's insight was, say, let's take the four dimensions with which we work all the time and notice that each of those dimensions has a real part and an imaginary part. So the statement of the eight space model is simply, space-time is complex. There's basically a four-dimensional real model that we experience every day, but our consciousness has access to a space-time whose substrate is our familiar four-space model, and we notice that each of those dimensions is complex. So you have a real up and down, and a complex up and down, a real back and forth. So for the four real dimensions, you also have four imaginary dimensions, so-called, and they're in pairs. So you have four, in the eight-space model, you still have four dimensions. Nothing's changed in that regard, except there are real and imaginary parts. Your consciousness has access to all of those parts, and the magical property, the thing that makes the eight space model, is that for any two points in the real space, like me in Palo Alto today, and Elizabeth in Los Angeles tomorrow, those are two distant points in ordinary space-time. She'll take the train and go to Los Angeles, and the clock will turn to be tomorrow, but she's still in the real plane. So for any two points in the real plane, although they're separated by space and time, there will always be a path through the eight space whose total ups and downs from me to that distant person, the sum total of that path is zero. So the Buddhist would say, there's no separation. How do I know what Elizabeth is doing? She's here, there's no separation. So the eight-space model, you don't have a magical way of sending information. That is to say, the eight-space model is not a transference model. You're not sending information to the eight-space. It's a way of construing the space-time in which we live, such as for consciousness, there's always a path that has no distance at all.
Yes.
Very
talking about space, but I think it also goes to time, so that's an interesting phenomenon as well. Elizabeth, another question, or you want to make a comment?
Yeah, that's pretty good.
Okay. All right, someone way in the back.
I just want to thank Dr. Hurtak and ask, what was the last slide? What was that? What was
we showed a series of what we call cosmograms or cosmic pictures to give people
to see through very integrated complex geometries, how we can open up our consciousness.
That's my experience almost exactly.
Yes.
And so it's great to see it in an image. And I just wondered with your book, The Keys of Knowledge,
yes.
Since I my human mind has having challenges actually understanding that, is it useful to my consciousness to just open it up and continue to pick it up and do whatever? And
we find,
should I put it under my pillow at night?
Yes, that's how I learned relativity. I just stacked all my books on relativity by my bed.
We're very happy to be here with Elizabeth Rauscher and have our new book coming out with her. But for those who live in the Bay Area, we do have an ongoing group. It meets twice a month in San Jose. So if you're ever interested over by Winchester, it's an open group, so you can always participate with us. It meets Saturday nights about 5:30 to 8:30. And it talks about more of those realities. So if you want to learn a little bit more about, we'll say, the more philosophical side of consciousness, that's what we're introducing.
So we saw that consciousness side is also consistent with the traditions of natural science, but also the language of color and the language of sound. Certain areas of consciousness can be heightened, and one can use creative experiences very dynamically. So we invite you to always have other books that deal with the language of color systematically for those who are seriously interested in the future of how the artistic, the scientific, and the consciousness realm are now coming synergistically integrated into interplay.
But I think it's so important for people to realize that when you have that higher consciousness understanding of the universe that Russell and Elizabeth and all of us are talking about, we can use it for understanding things not only in the past, but in the future. I know I recently, last year, I won't say which ones they were, but I had two really strong deja vu experiences where I knew exactly what was going to happen before the event even took place. I'll say one thing. I've had a secretary that's worked for us for 13 years. I woke up with the other secretary saying, Lila doesn't work here anymore. That was in February. In August, her husband got cancer to the point of almost dying, and she needed to quit. I mean, that happened way in advance. And that's, to me, is just a real confirmation. There's another one, too, is even stronger. But anyway, that these other realities or dimensions, in this case, eighth space, and I was hoping Elizabeth would talk about this, really has all these realities coming together. And then you can tap into that to do things and learn things for yourself so you can help why you're here, what you're doing, how to solve problems for your own personal relationships.
So the bottom line here is we are trying to transit a culture of violence into a culture of peace. The international local media constantly bombards us with negativity, negative death, violence, wherever you look. And we are at a critical phase of being the avant-garde of trying to bring out the positive side of the future. So this is a step forward we must take collectively, not simply to think abstractly, but to realize that this collective consciousness we all are connected with can be used to engineer somewhat a new phase of a culture of peace.
But also making ourselves aware. I know just on another practical level, I did an event with Alan Steinfeld, associate with a friend of ours in New York. And I would like be here in California at like 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock at night and think, oh, I can't call Alan, it's too late. Well, within like 1 minute, he would call me. And Alan did a great event with Russell Targ, one of the top remote viewers in contemporary times with Russell was Alan Steinfeld. So it's you're connected, you know, you're really connected, and we don't make use of that. I think that's the most important thing. We don't make use, whether it's from positive things of sending peace and love to other parts of the planet, or simply to be able to use it in our personal lives to avoid traffic accidents. It can get very much down into the very basic. Elizabeth, I know you have something to say about this.
It's very interesting because I feel like most of what you have to work really hard in a physical plane to learn stuff, but most of the information comes from higher dimensions, like in dreams and so forth. And a thing happened to me recently that would look bad, but I saw it as a symbol of a change in my life that I was making. So it's like interpretation is very critical. And maybe all bad is not bad. It's a path. And I do agree that how are we going to turn the Titanic on this issue of war? I don't know, but the more the young people are getting it. I know young people just seem to, you know, they implicitly believe in remote viewing. And when I was living with the Hopi people, trying to explain remote viewing, they didn't realize it was other, because it was so implicit. I mean, the whole pattern of life was timeless. We just ended up at somebody's house and the spaghetti was ready. My son called it Hopi spaghetti. But
I have to say, she does a great job of remote viewing the food store.
Well, I've come back from that, and now I'm having troubles with, see, you see, every action has a reaction, so if you lose weight, your pants fall off.
But I see.
Very embarrassing.
No, I see. I get on Crunchyroll, I say, Elizabeth, what should I get at the food store? And she tells me whatever's on sale in the very front. Whatever it is, she knows exactly what it is, and I get it. I mean, just... But use it every day. See, that's what's so important. We've been so limited.
It is every day.
Yeah.
It is available every day. Yeah. And what I say is the key, and it is about the force, is to remind ourselves every day to be in touch with the good, to be in touch with the higher consciousness, and renew that contract to do good in the world. Because one of the big reasons for it is it's a heck of a lot of fun.
We thank you as we bring together our thoughts into timeless awareness. This is really a key insight. We're going into a timeless awareness when we begin to see the fuller picture of life, the dynamics of utilizing the gifts that are really within our transceivership. In more practical words, we are living biotransducers of an infinite mind interacting with an infinite specieshood along an infinite way. Let us push the envelope forward with joy, laughter, and wisdom. We thank you.
So we want to thank Jerry Jin and Mary Cummings and everyone else who's helpful. Don't forget to come back for Beverly Rubik in a couple months. And
I thank all of you for being
and
doing.
Come on, Russell.